Two brief comments before we read our lectionary text this morning from the Gospel of Luke. First was I was gathered with a few pastor friends on Friday night and asked my two other pastor friends what they were preaching on from the lectionary this Sunday, and neither of them chose this parable from the Gospel of Luke, which I was disappointed because I was hoping to get some pointers and some insight into this passage. Second comment, and the reason for my hope for some pointers, the great German theologian Rudolf Bultmann called this parable the problem child of all parables. It just won't behave. So I invite you, as you listen to God's word this morning, this difficult and somewhat confusing parable, to find what stirs in you. How is Spirit connecting with you and even troubles you? Because Jesus told us, to some extent, the purpose of a parable is to kind of get inside of us and trouble us a little bit and make us to ask lots of questions that maybe we can't answer. So listen to and for God's word this morning. Then Jesus said to the disciples, "There was a rich man who had a manager, and charges were brought to him that this man was squandering his property. So he summoned him and said to him, 'What is this that I hear about you? Give me an accounting of your management, because you cannot be my manager any longer.' Then the manager said to himself, 'What will I do now that my master is taking this position away from me? I am not strong enough to dig, and I am ashamed to beg. I have decided what to do, so that when I am dismissed as manager, people may welcome me into their homes.' So, summoning his master's debtors one by one, he asked the first, 'How much do you owe my master?' He answered, 100 jugs of olive oil. He said to him, 'Take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 50. Then he asked another, 'How much do you owe?' He replied, 100 containers of wheat. He said to him, 'Take your bill and make it 80. And his master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. For the children of this age are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than are the children of light. And I tell you, make friends for yourself by means of dishonest wealth, so that when it is gone, they may welcome you into the eternal homes. Whoever is faithful in a very little is faithful also in much, and whoever is dishonest in a very little is dishonest also in much. If then you have been faithful with dishonest wealth, who will entrust you to the true riches? And if you have not been faithful with what belongs to another, who will give you what is your own? No one can serve two masters. Either they'll hate the one and love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth." This is the word of the Lord. Are you sure? Why does Jesus and then Luke and then the owner within the parable commend the behavior of this dishonest manager? It is a strange and curious parable indeed. Well, one of the prominent themes in the Gospel of Luke that he talks about a lot is the proper use of wealth, and in particular, how our relationship to wealth affects our relationship with other people. So with this in mind, we see in this dishonest manager, this strange character, a profound and interesting change in his behavior. While he once seems to have acted dishonestly and irresponsibly, serving only himself, not managing, not working well as an employee, now due to his vulnerable state of news of losing his job, he acts to enrich others, lowering their debts. Now, yes, this has a double kind of win situation for him. He's trying to build friendships so that when perhaps he doesn't have a place to live, he will be welcomed into their homes. But he uses the economic system to establish relationships of mutual benefit. Now, one theory in the history of biblical literature is this. Biblical law stated that a Jewish person who received a loan could not be charged interest. So charging any more than the principal would have been an unlawful practice. But since it was difficult for poor people in particular to find anyone who would loan them money without any kind of compensation, historians note that loans were recorded often at higher amounts than their actual value to circumvent the prohibition against charging interest. So they're padding their loans to make their money, right? So this inflated loan amount would have gone to the loan manager. Here arrives our dishonest manager. And if the loan manager was corrupt, he may have been greatly overcharging for these loans, as well as squandering his employer's money. So perhaps, when the loan manager was found out and lowered the bills, he may have been correcting the bills back to their original intended amount and forfeiting his own pay. What he was skimming off the top, we might say today. And by doing this, he would have been shrewdly turning from his own dishonesty and the corruption built into the economic loan system of that time to give back to these people what was rightly theirs to begin with. Now, this is just a theory. But regardless of the accuracy of this theory, it demonstrates something of this shrewdness and prudence and wisdom of the relationship that this man had with his money to benefit others. This pivot, this shift that perhaps happened in him as he came to his own demise. He has not only allowed the loss of the job to ruin, he has not allowed the loss of his job to ruin him. And furthermore, he demonstrates his somewhat detached relationship with wealth and money. He's not panicking about his money, employment, or provision. He's actively seeking an alternative to poverty and despair and unemployment. You might say he has a healthy relationship to money and wealth. And perhaps, particularly because Luke adds at the very end a very explicit teaching of Jesus's, perhaps this is the point that the parable is trying to insert itself into our lives to ask this question. What is your relationship with money and wealth? How do you finish this phrase? I believe money is... How does money affect you? Do you work for money? How often do you think or worry about money in your life? How often does it dictate the way you make decisions in your life? How does wealth exert its power in your life, in your work, and in our church? Again, perhaps this is why Luke bookends this very strange parable with Jesus' clear and climactic statement that begs all of us to assess our relationship with money. No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Now, money can be used for many things, as the shrewd manager demonstrates, but it cannot promise security, at least not for long. God is our only security. And for this reason, money is to be received and used and utilized, but cannot be the orienting reality of our life and decisions. We cannot worship both God and money, or as Jesus said elsewhere, wherever our treasure is, there our heart will be also. Friends, we live in a culture that idolizes and worships and perpetuates the myth that more is better. And none of us ever has enough. So we do what we have to do to get ours. We work all the time to make more money and ensure our investments are secure so that we can coast into the future of retirement. Maybe it's because of my age, but I feel like I see more and more commercials on television telling me that I need to be saving and get my stuff together for retirement. Our hearts and minds are constantly inundated with messages of scarcity and that drive us to get more and more and more. Friends, wealth is an active power that can inhibit our ability to freely follow Jesus. Wealth is a spiritual reality that demands our allegiance and power. In fact, the Greek word in this verse 13 means actually enslaved, not serve. So the verse actually reads, "You cannot be enslaved to God and money." The only other time this Greek word is used in Luke's gospel is in the story of the prodigal son, when the older son says to the father, "I've been enslaved to you." And if you know that parable, the older son did not have the healthiest relationship with his father. He felt indebted. He felt obligated. He felt loyal to his father. And Luke is saying, through Jesus' teaching, you cannot have both of those realities as one who follows God and one who interacts with money. Money and wealth are not evil in and of themselves, but they have the power and ability to enslave us if we are not, like this shrewd manager, discerning and wise and see its potential to take hold of us. In the other Hebrew lectionary reading for this Sunday, the prophet Amos calls out God's people who have become enslaved to money and wealth and are participating in a perpetuating economic system that keeps people in pervasive poverty. Listen to these startling and heavy words from the prophet Amos. "Hear this, you who trample on the needy and bring ruin to the poor of the land, saying, 'When will the new moon be over so that we may sell grain? And the Sabbath, so that we may offer wheat for sale. We will make an ephah, a smaller, and the shekel heavier, and practice deceit with false balances, buying the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals, and selling the sweepings of the wheat.'" And then these words, "The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their deeds." See, in their time, and I might argue in our time, people were messing with scales, messing with prices, and they were working 24/7. They're saying, "When is the Sabbath day over so that we can begin working?" And there was and is societal pressure to work more and sell more, to do more, to get more. And in the process of doing so, they kept people poor in perpetual poverty. See, friends, there are ramifications to a system like this, and I might even say a system like ours, that span beyond our immediate sphere of influence when we participate in systems that are enslaved to the amassment of wealth. We trample on the needy and bring ruin to the poor, sometimes even in our own unconscious reality. And perhaps this is why Jesus commends this dishonest manager, because he seems to be flipping the script of the story of their economic situation. This scarcity-driven, frenetic, impersonal economic system that tramples on the needy and brings ruin to the poor. He chooses not to serve that system and be enslaved by that system, but he chooses to enter in and change the system. Instead of simply being a victim of his own circumstances and the system, he transforms a bad situation into one that, yes, benefits himself. And this is the part that's troubling and difficult for us. But he does it for others by reducing other people's debts that may have been inflated to begin with. He creates a new set of relationships, not based on pay and reception, a simple monetary exchange relationship between lenders and debtors, but he redistributes the power and wealth that perhaps he took advantage of with a reciprocal and equal relationship among friends. This dishonest manager is indeed shrewd. He knows how to play the economic game and has possibly played it to his own advantage. And maybe I'm looking too naively and idealistically on this simple parable of Jesus and this dishonest manager, but I have to want to wonder if in that moment when he lost his job, it didn't all come flooding to him. What have I done? How have I gotten into this situation where I've taken advantage of people? How have I become so indebted, enslaved, attached to my own monetary gain? And now I'm potentially out on the streets. He knows the insidious power of wealth and money if we are not awake and alert to how it can take control of our lives. This religion of money and wealth has the potential to enslave us. You either play the system or the system plays you. So like every good parable, I just want to close with a few questions for us. First, notice what's stirring in you right in this moment if you're listening. How are you feeling? What's your heart rate like? Money is a hard thing to talk about, and we are told that it's the reason why many people don't come to church. So I just want to name that as a reality. But here's some questions for us to ponder both individually and collectively as East Liberty Presbyterian Church. How can we just become more aware of our personal financial practices and how we participate in a larger economic system? How can we use our wealth and power? And when I say this word wealth, you don't have to be wealthy to have wealth. To broaden our relationships and empower the poor, subverting the system and acting more shrewdly and wisely and prudently in our relationship to our money and wealth. What questions get stirred in you about your own financial practices this morning? And what would it look like to have a conversation with someone this week about your own financial practices? What might it look like if our church became a place where we could actually talk about money and help each other think more clearly about our economic lives, both personally and collectively as a church? And then as a church in specific, what might it look like as a finance committee, a property committee, the session, to budget shrewdly? And that is not a leading question. I don't know the answer to that question. To use the multitude of wealth that we sit in, that we have, that we possess, to build relationships with those in need, to use our power and our privilege to redistribute wealth, ensuring that we are not accidentally trampling on the needy and bringing ruin to the poor. I'm catching the face of Frank Bowerly out there. Sorry, Frank, for naming you. And Frank and I served on the board of Open Hand Ministries, one of our mission partners. And if you don't know about Open Hand Ministries, I think it's because I've seen Frank's face. This is a beautiful ministry that is seeking to do everything that I'm describing this morning. So maybe that's one answer for us to ponder. So friends, as children of the light, as Jesus puts it in his parable, may we have the courage to act more shrewdly, wisely, and prudently as it relates to our money and wealth. For we know in the depths of our heart that we cannot serve two masters, both God and money. May God give us the wisdom and the creativity to make it so. Amen.